Good evening. I'd like to open the Deerfield Planning Board meeting Monday, February 1st, 2015 at 5:07 here at the town offices. Tonight's agenda is to review the minutes from December 7th meeting, see if there's any public comment. We have some old business. New England Environmental is going to talk about the solar project up on River Road. We want to talk about potential review the zoning bylaws regarding lot size. We have some new business in A&R on Lower Road. And then we'll review mail and set the date for the next meeting. Anything else?
It should be said that it's the January meeting, not December minutes that we got to review.
Because we already reviewed the December one in January.
Did we do the December meetings? I think we did, yeah. Yep.
Yeah. So that's the January 4th meeting minutes we're going to look at.
There goes Amtrak.
I don't see Mickey here. Is anybody here from... You're from New England. That's right. All right. And then... And is anybody here from regarding the A&R, Karen Savage? All right. So maybe we can move some things around to help out with people who are here.
Sure.
All right. So we'll look at the minutes. Anybody want to make a motion? I should say we have a quorum, five of us, five out of seven. Mm-hmm. Rachel did express, she told me she wouldn't be able to make it.
Okay. And Roger, we don't know. He made sure.
Roger, usually first Monday of the month isn't a problem.
Usually makes it, so I haven't heard from him.
Like we've got one blank spot to fill in on the old business.
So the old business, so the five, it was actually over 5,000 was billed to Lake Street Development. That should be inserted there, right?
Lake Street Development.
All right, that looks like what we talked about.
All right, I'd like to make a motion that we accept the minutes.
I'd like to, yeah, okay. I'll second that.
Any comments or corrections? Inserting that.
Some question in my mind, and I think...
About the minutes or about an issue?
About the old business and the fact that the town actually... build Lake Street Development, not for COG. I think there was a question at our last meeting who was going to bill them. And I think...
The town did.
The town actually did, and the town got paid for it. So So I don't know if we need to change anything there to just make that clear or not, but...
Well, the bill, discussion ensued on the bill from the FERCOG to the town.
Right.
That's fine.
Yep. I think we did it right. I'm not saying we did it wrong. I'm just saying that, just so we understand that when we pay her, the town, the FERCOG bill, that part of that's that $5,000 that comes out of our revolving fund to pay them, to pay the FERCOG. You know what I mean?
Okay, we're doing the minutes now. Is there any corrections you need to make there?
Or? Well, that's why I'm trying to say, in this old business, should we try to make it clear as to what's happening? Or do you want to address it later?
If you want to make it clear tonight, let's do that tonight, but let's just...
Okay, because part of our discussion at the last meeting was that topic, so that's why I'm...
Yeah.
You know, we can do it by doing it at our meeting tonight.
But otherwise, it's correct.
What's that?
The minutes are correct.
He's saying they're not as thorough as maybe he'd want, so...
In other words, at the last meeting, it was some discussion about whether or not the FERCOG could build them direct for this or whether we had to build them.
No, the answer was no. The town of Deerfield did.
The town of Deerfield.
I mean, that's just...
I'm not questioning that, John. I think you're absolutely right.
Right.
I'm just saying it's not in the minutes as to how that was to be handled, but we can address it today.
Later. Let's start anew. Otherwise, we're...
Okay. All right. That's fine, then.
All right. So there's a motion to accept the minutes and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? 500. They're approved. So we'd like to take a moment to see if there's any comments from the public about anything that we should be considering here at the planning board that's not on tonight's agenda. Hearing none?
Yeah. I'm just thinking about something because it was something that got brought up earlier today.
And our public is Doug.
Hi. I was talking with the building commissioner earlier today. For the second time in a year, we've received a request from an outside vendor looking to place a self-storage facility in Deerfield. And he's looking around for a place, either a piece of land or a facility where that might actually happen. Always very interested in helping businesses grow themselves in Deerfield, we, of course, started looking around. The biggest limitation is the fact that the zoning doesn't allow for it, except for in the planned industrial zone, which is the industrial park.
Weren't we going to make that one of our
we were aware of that, and were going to discuss it, and it just kind of got put off, but we could do that this evening.
It was a change that was on either the annual or the special town meeting that happened last spring. I don't think it was the April meeting. I think it was the one in June. Remember how we had that weird special meeting? We were going to make a change to the zoning to allow for self-storage facilities in, I think, planned industrial and C2, if memory serves, or it was in the EPD district, in the expedited permitting district, and it got voted down. Town meeting chose not to approve it.
Well, I think the planning board's recommendation was not to approve it.
Right,
at the time.
Right.
And in that same thing, we said we'll look into trying to make it available to see if it should be available some places in town.
Because the reason we voted against that was because it was in one particular area for one particular situation, and that's what we didn't like. So
sure, and I don't disagree with that sentiment generally, but because this request has come up a second time, I'm just reiterating the request and hoping that the planning board can take a look at that. I know you're looking at other zoning changes, potential changes to the zoning bylaws. This might be something to consider.
Yep. So, no, good point. So that did fall off our radar, so let's get it on the agenda. Maybe tonight, tonight.
We have a sign-in sheet, Doug?
All right.
I don't have one prepped, no.
Okay.
Thank you. Next item is old business about New England Environmental and the solar project on 901 River Road. So we had a...
I'm going to recuse myself.
Yes, you are. This is the one topic that you continue to recuse yourself as an employee of the...
Do we have a pad of paper or something to get the list of guests?
I'll get a sheet.
Okay.
So we got an email over the past week that went to the Conservation Commission and us that the developers of the solar array on 901 River Road wanted to make a slight change of location in the solar panels. Both myself and the CONCOM chair asked that we hear more about it at our meetings because it wasn't quite clear on the map that we got. So we asked a representative to come, and it seems like a slight change, but we wanted to just verify that. And if there's no problems, we'll write a letter just saying that these changes are acceptable to us. So I forget your name. Sorry.
It's Kevin.
Kevin.
And last name is McCaffrey.
Could you spell it?
McCaffrey.
So if you can just, you know, we all know the project pretty well. So the main thing I think we wanted is just what was changing from what we had approved, you know, just
sure,
a month or
sure
two ago.
And are you from NEE?
Yes, I'm the civil engineer for New England Environmental.
So I was hoping, and I asked actually a before and after.
I've got the old one right here on
okay
the back. The main changes are along the southern boundary and then the west and east side. The summary is that, you know, before we had this inner panel area and then a sort of perimeter area that was going to be managed for shade trees.
Mm.
This outer boundary is still the same. You know, we're not asking to drop that any further south.
Right.
A couple of things happened. Right as permitting was sort of drawing to a close, we started the boundary survey process because we need to establish a lease boundary here for the landowner to kind of carve this piece out of their property and lease it out. And they did some deed research, and we had assumed the width of this right of way was 350 feet, and it's actually 250. So they picked up, it was still on their property all along, and it was an easement, but now they realized they had another 100 feet to work with. And before, we had kept the limit of the structures at the edge of that easement. So that applies for the south side of the property. And then the other thing that happened is they got in, and I don't know if you recall, but you had some concerns about steep slopes. And the construction team kind of got in there and got their eyes on that, and they said, yeah, that is pretty steep. And so they decided to pull some of these panels back here and then also along the east side. So I'll give you this. I don't have them side by side, but so what you'll see is, you know, we still have this shade management zone on the south, but we're bringing the panels down 100 feet or so. And then coming in on the east and west and east sides. So you see there, they're eliminating quite a few strings there.
Mm.
The capacity of the whole project is going to be pretty much the same. The panel count is actually a little less, but they're going with a more efficient panel. And that's kind of happening on all our projects. By the time these things actually get put in the ground, the panels that are available are even better than when they first laid it out. So the sort of overall strategies are all still the same. You know, we're going to stay 25 feet from wetlands. Like I said, we still have this outer perimeter that's the same. The access road location is still the same. There will be a slight increase in length here. Since we're bringing this down a little bit, that spur will get a little bit longer, and that inverter has just moved up that hill a little bit. But the total number of inverters is all the same. One change here as a result of bringing this to the east, it only made sense to bring this retention basin up with that. So we're going to tuck, you know, before that was down closer to the property line, we're going to tuck that up in here. Because that will need to be cleared, where this area will just be managed for shade trees, you know. So we'll keep the real clearing sort of contiguous to itself here. So that's sort of the summary. If there are detailed questions, be happy to answer them.
So this you went to the Conservation Commission the other night?
Yep. Went there on Thursday. They were fine with everything, and they voted to approve the change.
I was looking for their
It's right there underneath that computer.
Is it? Because I knew I talked to the chair, and he said it wasn't a problem, but...
Yeah, I didn't see an actual letter or anything yet.
Right down on the desk. There you go. Okay, see it right there under the... there you go. I think that's it there.
Yeah, this is it too, actually.
John, did you happen to get a copy of that email when it showed the plan with the overlay?
No, I never did. That's why I kind of...
I got one. I don't have it with me, but I got
one. The new one and the old one?
Yeah.
Oh. Oh, that's cool.
I have that one that was sent out. It's a little busy. Okay.
So here's the... So the CONCOM met on January 28th, and this is their... meeting minutes. It says notice of intent, 901 River Road, minor changes to the plan accepted previously. We discussed with the construction company. The changes consisted of relocating some panels due to steepness of the terrain, were found to be minor and acceptable to the commission. No additional paperwork is required. And I think that was actually what they said too, is that less getting away from the steeper place is actually probably better for water management purposes.
When you looked at the overlay map, the difference was negligible. Yeah. It really was.
Yeah, I think this is the one that was sent out with that summary letter. And like I said, it's a little busy.
Yeah, there were a lot of arrows and this and that on it.
But you can, down here you can see the old layout of panels underneath there. And then the new ones extending out a little bit further. And then same thing through this zone here.
So I'm curious, it looks like it shifts a little bit towards the high tension wires and to Keats Road a little bit, but not too much, I guess.
Yeah, this is very southern extent. There's a pretty limited change, total change there.
No, we don't. We got ours already. Thank you.
All right, anybody have any questions about it?
I reviewed it and I didn't see anything. It was so close, like I said, it didn't seem to be any different.
I actually Pat Smith, our technical assistance person, got a copy of it and she looked at it also. And from again, what we can tell, it didn't look like much. She actually expressed a pleasure, I guess it might say, that they came forth with this change and showed us different diagrams, and we appreciate that, doing it quickly and early on.
Sure.
And communicating well. She thinks she's done a lot of these different projects around the county and said that the communication with this group has been pretty good.
Yeah.
She's helpful.
Well, then I'd make
a... I think what we... No further.
I don't think we have anything else to...
One of the questions was that, and I think the CONCOM is that we'd like to get a as-built.
Sure.
Because I think with the original, what we approved, and this is something that we talked about, we always kind of want that. Because often when we approve something and then in construction, if things move, whether it's a few feet or whatever, it's always good to have an as-built. Sure. So I guess that's something maybe we should say.
You know, through the process of closing out the NOI... You know, we have to file paperwork to say that that's complete, essentially. Yeah. And that would be the kind of thing that would go in with that, is, you know, a record drawing of how things were actually constructed.
Right.
So we'd be, you know, that'd be an easy enough thing to copy the planning board on. That submittal.
And the inverters didn't change location much, did they?
No, like I said, that one at the southern end of the spur road there is going to go just, you know, maybe 100 feet south or 50 feet south, right here. You know, since this group of panels is coming down to the south, that road will get extended a little bit there.
Because on one of the maps, because it was so small, it looked like the inverter was like really much further over towards the wires there. But I can see now it's pretty...
No, I think you're still, you're still 200 feet from the edge of panels there. So.
All right, good. All right, so you want to...
I make a motion that we accept the changes as are.
And that we request the...
Request the as-built plan.
As-built plans.
Which would be part of the Conservation Commission's paperwork anyways.
Yeah.
I'll second it.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain? Excellent.
Great. Thank you.
So the only stipulation we're putting on it is that we have an as-built at the end of the project.
Yeah.
That's it.
Okay.
So do you put in the minutes, Paul, that, that John accused himself from that part
yes,
of this?
Yes, please. I will do that.
Thanks. All right, can I ask that we move our A&R up above zoning bylaw review,
sure.
since the applicant's
sure.
here, and yep. we can have it all right in front of us?
Let's get it done.
Would you like to come forward and tell us, I have the, I have some plans I can...
And what is your connection with the A&R?
Essentially, my connection is my mother-in-law is letting her daughter, my wife, subdivide on her existing property to build a home.
Paul, would you like one?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll move on.
So I have a, we received an application. This one is not stamped by the... by the town, but maybe there's another one in here. Hold on.
So you're effectively carving out 1.461 acres from
exactly, and
from the lot.
Leaving her existing lot, and then there'll be one more lot to our north, or.
Do you know if this...
South, sorry.
I don't have the stamped application. Do you know if it...
There was an application.
It was with it.
It's here, but it doesn't... It wasn't...
Wasn't stamped received?
There's nothing from the town office about it.
Did you pay the fees and stuff?
I came in and I spoke with Doug and I spoke with the building inspector and I brought all this with me. And they said... leave it with us and you should be all set, not piece of cake. So I haven't paid a fee yet for, I was told that it would pay a fee now if it was approved.
Those generally go to the clerk's office, don't they?
Yeah, the clerk usually gets it and they stamp that you paid 50 or 100 or whatever and all the...
Yeah, it should be a...
Because then the disc should be there too. I don't see that either.
Did Dan give you a disc? A digital disc of all this land?
No, I don't have that either.
Well, let's go through it and then we might not be able to
reschedule. I can get all the information that's required.
Yeah, we can do a conditional thing maybe or something if we need to.
Basically, the idea of obviously to have it done, but we need to get it deeded, so I was going to go and get it deeded, so I don't know if a conditional would allow for that to happen, or...
What's the fee supposed to be?
Doug said he wasn't sure when I spoke with him, so...
I think it's supposed to be 100, or is it, did we decide 150?
We have our new fee schedule, of course.
Yeah, that's why I was asking.
And it's actually...
it's the same as it was for that.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. So it's... A&R is $100 basic fee plus $50 each for the proposed net number of new lots.
So $150.
So your request is to take one building lot out of the existing property.
Yes.
So that would be in one additional lot. So
yeah.
$150. All right. So you can tell us we've got the thing in front of us here, I guess. You're on Lower Road?
Yeah. Karen's address is 147 Lower Road, so it's sort of going away from Deerfield towards Greenfield.
Just down from Jones Cross Road.
Yeah, sort of paralleling 91 right before Wisdom Way would be the next cross street.
Yeah. All right. And the frontage of the new lot is 225 feet, so that's...
That sounds about right.
More than the 200 required.
Ooh. I don't see any crazy angles.
No, the angles look good. This is the sharpest angle.
Oh, 60,000 is our square foot right now, and that's a 63, no big angles.
There can't be anything less than 100 feet. He's got that.
There's the thing about accessibility, so we sometimes want to know slopes, but I don't know if that's an issue on...
No, it's that the access is right off a lower road where it's planned, so yeah. It meets all the requirements.
And then the other property still goes around it. It's not
right.
It's not like make anything like that.
Correct.
This,
yeah.
This is just one big property yep. around it.
Huh. Well, I'd like to make a motion that we accept. We don't accept it. We approve it. Right.
Oh yeah.
Yep.
Endorse it. We endorse it.
Yep.
I'll second the motion.
With the condition, prior to a building permit being issued, all fees are paid.
Well, I'm sure he'll come in tomorrow the next day.
Well, no, I mean, but yeah.
I have my checkbook now if I can.
Does this say what it's supposed to say? Endorsement does not certify the lot shown. All right, that's good.
Well, do we want to take his check tonight and give it to the clerk tomorrow?
We can just put it on the paperwork.
Yeah, if you got a check with you?
Yeah.
Oh, that'd be perfect.
All right, then we can sign it.
Yeah.
We can, we can all feel good about that.
It's town of Deerfield?
Yep.
What is it, John, 150?
150, because it's 100, and then they're making one new lot, so it's $50 for that.
Is there a plan number, any way to note on his check what...
He can put in his memo...
Does that have a street address yet?
Not yet. No. I could do 147 Lower Road.
Sure.
In the memo.
Yeah, it's an A&R from 147.
Well, just so they don't get the check and.
My mother-in-law will be very happy. We just had a baby 3 months ago, so she's excited that we'll be neighbors.
Oh, I'm sure she is.
Yeah.
And then we got three paper copies. We have the Mylar.
That motion on the.
And so we need a compact disc.
I can't move the motion.
I can talk to Dan and
did you
see.
Second?
Yeah, he usually. He usually does them at the same time.
Max, did you second that motion on the solar?
Yes.
Yeah, these are the contents of the plans. They usually check these things off, but they're not. But I can see them all here. So we actually have, we have this. We need the compact disc, and then they usually make a copy of this, one to give to you and one to give to us. So.
I do have one copy, a paper copy of the survey at home.
No, of the application, too, we usually. It says two copies of the signed Form A. So this is Form A.
Does it say on that checklist to go to the clerk's office with it?
It's supposed to, yeah.
Well, town clerk stamp.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you want, John, I'd be glad to come in tomorrow. We could make sure that it all gets done if you want to.
I don't know why Doug or Dick didn't tell you to do that.
I know. That's pretty standard. That's not unusual.
Did they think there was going to be an issue with it?
No, I was here. I spoke with Doug, and then I spoke with Dick, and he said, oh, it's a piece of cake, no problem. And they took all my paperwork that I had with me, so.
All right.
I think we should just keep we should sign the paper, keep it here, make sure all the work is completed, and then you can stop by and pick it up after everything is done. And
well, I appreciate that. Sorry.
That's what I would say. I don't know what the rest of the board.
That's a fair solution.
That sounds good. So You made a motion?
I did.
We didn't vote on this yet, did we?
I made the motion. Kip seconded it. We've had our discussion.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain. All right. 5-0.
So, John, you made the motion and Kip seconded. Is that right, or did I get it
Correct.
Backwards?
No, you got it right.
Oh, you got it right.
Okay.
I think we just use pen because we never have sharpies.
I think we've just been using a pen.
Do you have one over there too?
Yeah.
Let's read you.
Okay.
Can we sign this as well?
Mm-hmm. Did you?
Oh, you want to sign this one?
Today is 2.
All right, you got that, and then so I'll clip that to this, and then tomorrow I'll come in and they'll do the puts the town clerk stamp on here, and then you should probably get a copy of it.
Okay.
And pick up.
Well, we'll keep
pick up these copies that, and you can take them to the register then.
Great, I really
appreciate it. All right,
thanks a lot.
Looks
do we have
good.
Another
have
one
fun.
To sign, or is nice three table. All we need to do, John?
No, we need to get at least 4. So
you got everything you need?
Yep.
Okay. Yep.
Great. Thanks a lot, guys.
Okay.
And you got his name for the minutes?
Yes, it's Kevin.
All right.
Gabriel
Dark.
Yep.
Kevin is the guy from the NE. Okay,
all right, don't get everybody
more.
Confused now.
Here's
three. We'll sign it and then we'll be done. Yeah, it's my pen.
Oops.
I stole it fair and square from the church. No, they give them away.
I was going to say. I'll say that on the record anyway.
Okay.
I'll just clip all these together. Jeez, these things take off on you. All right, back to the minutes. Yeah, let's get them pulled up and clipped together. So the old business we have is zoning bylaw review. We were talking about lot size review and where we want to go with that. So, Kip, you've taken the lead on this. You want to?
Yeah, I
up to date.
You know, I've been approached by, you know, like the building inspector and other people about the size of building lots and the land use and stuff like that. And you know, I started looking into it and. I just brought this map that it really doesn't have anything to do except with the show. This is a piece of land that I had purchased back in the late 80s. And at the time, the lot frontage was 125 feet, and the area was 25,000 feet. This is something that was done before, you know, I did. I just happened to buy it. And, you know, there's 6 new homes over there. And there's also another, I don't know, this was another subdivision, I guess, off of Setright Road. It's very similar size of the lots. The road was curved. And so I Googled Earth a lot of areas of Deerfield. And what I found is that whenever the lots are like this, the houses and the yards are very well maintained. And when you get into areas where the, Millville Village, thank you. The homes are scattered out, you can see that a smaller portion of the yard is actually maintained, and even on these smaller lots, and the rest is all overgrown. So I kind of also think that when you have a lot of subdivision of land, like along Mill Village Road or Waitley Road or other areas, you could have more farmland available if the farmer opted to sell the building lots on the front, leaving backland instead of using up all the backland. And this was, I thought, a prime example, because if this was under the current rates, you'd lose about 5 acres of farmland, which now exists as farmland. Well, the other thing that I've always kind of thought was unfair is because you have to have more square footage, you're assessed a higher dollar value on your lot. So someone who has a half or, you know, 3/4 acre, their lot might be appraised at $80,000 or $90,000, but you have an acre and a half, it's $100,000 or $110,000. So that extra $20,000 to $25,000 turns into an extra $400 tax bill for the individual, whether or not they use the land. And also, it costs more, and everything's costing more and more and more, and it's more difficult for people to, you know, build homes and stuff. I thought that if the lots were smaller, that the cost of land might also help in the cost of the homes, you know, staying the same, if not increasing. And that, going back to like not only these homes, but if you look at all the other subdivisions like that, there never seemed to be a big problem with the land being like that. And I think that, in my opinion, that it was changed and it was used as a zoning tool because they thought the town was going to be overrun with children and our schools weren't going to be able to handle it. And I'm not really sure why, but that's the avenue it went down. So, you know, I think that it would be a good idea to lessen the frontage requirements and the square footage requirements in the RA district alone. And what I had come up with a plan or an idea to do it is I copied the page out of our book, and right now it says minimum size lot is 60,000. Leave that as 60, but also below it add 40, and then put a little number 9 as our table. And number 9, if you would read it, it would say it would be 40,000 square feet when the lot is served by either town water or town sewer or both. So what that would mean is if somebody had a building lot where there was no water available and no sewer available, the lot would stay the same at 60,000 square feet. I think that's a pretty good size for a lot because you have to manage the location of a well and a septic system and keep a minimum distance of 100 feet. But the big unknown is not always where your well is and where your septic is, but where your neighbor's well is and where your neighbor's septic is. So with that 60,000 square feet, I think that's good. It gives everybody enough room. Even if one person chose to put their septic system right on a property line, your new lot at 60,000 square feet would give you enough distance to put a well far enough away from your septic system and the other one. But if you had one or the other, in most of places in Deerfield, you would have town water. You'd only be dealing with the septic system. So
just to clarify, 60 or 40 with an asterisk there, the number 9, is that where there is town
water. Or sewer.
Or sewer.
Or both.
Or both.
Well, that would be CVRD now.
Right now, but, you know, it just kind of, I don't want to say it plans for the future, but it delineates that, you know, you have to have one or the other, or both. Yeah.
Is there any RA that has water and or sewer?
I believe all our sewer is in commercial and CVRD.
It doesn't cross the 90%.
In fact, that last zoning change that we did on North Main Street, or North Main Street.
Was to correct that.
And that.
Because there was sewer,
that turned
so we wanted to make.
That was residential agriculture, and that was changed to CVRD to put the lots into.
Everything west of 91 has got, you know, up to a certain line has got water, but no sewer.
But you're thinking the larger size is largely might be necessary because of septic systems.
Yeah.
You don't want to get people too close together.
My own experience, I happen to own some property in another town where it's very gravelly. And in Montague, they only require a one-acre parcel of land with no water and sewer. It was very easy to deal with that because of the good drainage of the soil. Deerfield's not fortunate to always have that. You know, we have a lot of areas where there's a lot of silt and clays and stuff like that. So, you know, it's not a perfect scenario to say, okay, this well can go here and this septic can go here. Sometimes you have to hunt around for a spot for that septic system. So I feel that, you know, by leaving that at the 60,000 square feet, we'd actually kind of be doing people a service, because if we made it all 40,000 square feet, it would make it, it could make it very tight for somebody, and then they would be having problems and stuff like that, which, you know, we don't want to do. But in that absence, I think that it makes sense to, even at 40,000, that's still nearly double of what it used to be, and it's three times what it is in the CVR, CRVD, or
CVRD.
CVRD.
Central Village Residential.
I don't disagree with Kip as far as the overall size, but I think what we should do is do a field trip and go to some homes that have been built in the past, whatever, 5 years, with a tape measure and a wheel, and see what's actually, how much area these are actually taking up. I mean,
you know what's a good way of doing it, and I kind of learned this just recently, if you look at Google Maps, and you can get an aerial shot, and there's a little scale right down there, and you can scale. Now, of course, not being there, you don't know how far the house is from it, but, you know, I think in most areas, our setback rules are 50 feet, so you can kind of use that as a guide. Also, kind of looking at the house, so you can see where the setbacks are and stuff like that. I know the homes on this particular place over on Plain Road, even before I bought this, all of the homes along Plain Road were like that, you know, from the 70s on. And it seemed to be, you know, it's a nice neighborhood, and every, you know, it all works good. And if you look at that Google map thing, the aerial view, you see all, the same thing all the way across, you know. And it doesn't take much, because if you turn and you kind of come down the other side and you see where the lots are bigger, you see the disparity. You know, it's just like it's all woods and overgrown and, you know.
I'll still say I think we should take a field trip someday.
What would you be looking for, John?
Well, I would probably start us off over at the latest house built on 116 going around the corner, Max Skalski's.
Yep.
Because that's going to be the maximum end of the spectrum with that house being built. You know, going to neighbors towards Conway.
Okay. Yep.
Then over by my house, there's homes that were built 10 years ago there. See how much actual footprint, you know, because the lots are the size of the lots, how much actual footprint was used during the construction phase. And I do believe you're probably right as far as, because those are town water, I think we can get away with reducing from 60 to an acre, providing there's enough room for a secondary septic system, but I think we should go out and physically look, so you can envision the topography. You know, these lots that you're looking at there, that was well before all the septic rules have changed. And
well, you know, yes and no. I mean, the rules for septics have changed since this was done, but not in the overall size of it. You know, you have to go from a 1,000-gallon tank to a 1,500-gallon tank, which is really only about 18 inches in all directions. The actual square footage of the leach field is still around 1,000. It's
well, yeah, but as far as your separation from the water table, which elevates the field, you know, if you look at some of the homes that were built years ago, mm-hmm. and now they have to put a new septic system, you see a house and you see a big mound, whereas where you have the houses being built today, they take that into consideration when they're building the house. They elevate the house, and the slopes go away from the house. And the
well, that's true, but I mean that still wouldn't affect the size of the lot, and that, you know, it's funny because you know, I was the one who really kind of got this whole raised system ball going, because up until 1988, you couldn't put in a raised system. It was illegal in illegal in Deerfield. And I challenged the town, and they changed it. They had to change it. And so now you do see a lot of these raised systems, and the science has changed, so it really kind of, it's kind of gone from one extreme to another. And you do see these very large mounds that, you know, I don't want to say they're unnecessary, but they're very large, let's put it that way. And you're right, that if in a new house going forward, you know, you know this beforehand, so you can change the elevation of your foundation and bring in fill or whatever. You know, I don't see how, you know, how we could anticipate that, you know, now. I mean,
well, you know, when you elevate it, you need a little bit more room to get your slope so they look halfway decent, and you know, so so that's where I'm, you know, so you need, actually, you do need more land today than you did back when those.
Oh, exactly, and that's what I'm saying. These were 25,000, so if we go up to 40, you know, that's 15,000 square feet, and you know, the overall septic system itself is only 1,000, so it does give you a lot of area to go away from. Even if you were had to bring it up the maximum, which is 5 feet, you know, and you have a 2% slope, if a 5-foot elevation, you could dissipate that real fine in 40 feet, you know, and it would give you.
So remind us, what's the benefit to the town of having a smaller lot size?
Well, there's a couple. One is that, you know, possibly depending on where, it would use less land. Okay, it would take up less land.
What would take up? The land's the land.
Well, in this particular lot, all of Plain Road, not just this section, but if you imagine all of Plain Road that goes all the way up, they're all the same. So if...
You're saying it would take less farmland.
Less farmland.
Okay, so if farmland preservation is one of our goals of the town, then I want to match up the needs of the town and all these studies we've done, and if it makes sense, that's such a good thing. Because it's either this person's land or that person's land, but if you're saying it's taking it away from farmland, that's a...
Well, it could be, you know. But
Potentially.
Depending on where. But I mean, that's one of the things that, you know, a lot of times people will say, well, you know, development's taking away a lot of, you know, good agricultural land, stuff like that. And, you know, I see that argument, and I understand it. But what you also have to understand is that people who farm this land and have paid taxes on it for years and years and years, and they might be thinking, hey, this is their retirement. And, you know, why should they not be able to sell it?
I want to check off the potential good things for Deerfield. So saving some farmland is great.
That could be.
What else?
And then they have the – it also – by having a larger parcel of land, it creates an unfair tax burden to the people who have a larger parcel of land. For the mere fact,
I'd like to go do the studies on that, because if it's a building lot of 40,000 square feet or a building lot of 60,000 square feet,
there's a different value.
You think it's that much of a?
Oh, it is definitely. Yeah, I look. I almost.
Do assessors do it based on square footage, or do they do it on? Valuable the land is.
They do it on a combination of both.
Yeah.
And it's a combination of the square foot and location, you know.
So that means less tax dollars.
I was going to say, so a lower tax bill to the individual is also less taxes
to the
town.
It's more taxes for everybody else.
It means you spread it out, I guess. But
you can't look at it that way. You can't.
It's just a reality, is what we're saying. It's
yeah, but if you, yeah. Well, yeah, but then on the other flip side, you'd have more houses, so you can divide it up. And the thing about that too is that, you know, you constantly hear about, you know, senior housing, and, you know, this goes on and on. And I mean, the taxes are going to keep going up. The community keeps needing more revenue, and that, you know, because our population is actually getting older and older. I mean, you think about it, that things like this would make it easier for younger people to come into town. Could make it easier. It also could make it.
How would it make it easier?
Because it would be less expensive.
If the building lot is.
Do you really think that it's going to reduce the cost of the building lot?
Sure, it would.
Well,
sure
in, would. In theory, the land value should go down by a third.
If you can't,
well, no, that's what I'm saying. It doesn't, because it's the value of the land.
A lot is a lot. Yes.
Not whether you can have a. grow trees on. And
I guess I'd dispute that, because when you get your bill, it says so much for the land, so much for the property, the building. So.
And good building land is valued higher than lousy than on a hillside that you can't build land
But if you cut, if you cut the size of the lot by a third, then you'd think the taxes on the land portion should go down.
That's
by
what he's saying. It'll go down, maybe not in proportion.
It isn't. What is it?
If you look at several pieces of land, and you know, it doesn't matter if you're in the Central Village District or the RA District, and the lots that are a half an acre all are around the $80,000 to $85,000 range. The minute you go out into the RA where the lots are, you know, an acre and a half or 2 acres, the lot values go up to $110 to $120.
Well, now you're comparing CVRD and residential agricultural.
Not necessarily.
Or anyway, we're proposing, because let me just quickly go back. So this is all, we can just get the thing started. This has to go to a public hearing, and then the public, a zoning bylaw change requires a town meeting.
I understand that.
So I just want to have us kind of list it. We really don't need to debate it too long here, do we?
Well, but I would really like to have a planning board meeting field trip. So we can go physically see what these houses that have been built in the last 10 years in the IRA look like, measure them up, you know, make a few phone calls maybe to the owners to tell them that.
We should have plans.
I know what I was going to say. You could go to the, or we could ask our building inspector.
Yeah, but that's not going to show us. It's going to, if we go out and physically measure, okay, the
well, wait a minute. The dimensions are on the plans in the
Yeah, but not for where the toe of the slopes end, and there's no as-builts for these.
Yeah, there are, well, a lot of them, because anytime there's a septic system, you have to have, you know, topography for that.
Well, I think it's a lot different than actually looking.
I understand that, but it,
I don't know. That's what I think, but I'm just throwing it out there.
So what are the other positive things for the town of Deerfield?
I think it would encourage people building smaller houses, because you've got a smaller lot, and it's a bit, you know, it's a, you could put an 1,800 square foot house on a smaller lot versus, you know, having to go to, you know, 2,000 or 2,500. It'd allow you to scale things down.
Why would that make a difference? I mean, if somebody buys a lot, they're going to put the house they want on it.
Yeah, but
it allows you, you know, as a, you look at it and you go, okay, I get this much in the land, and I got to do this much on the building to make it, you know, something that's going to turn. If you're looking at it from a builder's perspective, you know, it allows you to build smaller houses.
Because I wonder about, you know, smart growth, whatever you talk about, is trying to make, use our resources more efficiently, and that's what I'm wondering. That could be a positive aspect of it. Instead of, you know, growth just out all over the place, it might be a little more compact near where the resources are.
Well, from what you're saying, if you got three lots for the place of two, then you'd get more tax money that way, I would think.
Well, you could build a house.
I mean, there's a lot of different avenues to look at it, you know, and you know it still boils down to that you're going to use up less land, and it can be more affordable. You know, there was a time in town where, you know, everybody wanted to build and stuff like that, and prices of building lots really skyrocketed up. Well, that day is gone, you know, and it's cheap. You know, there are lots around, you know, that have been sitting for a while. They're $40,000, and, you know, maybe they're not in the most desirable location. I just think that, you know, by having a smaller size building lot just makes a lot more sense. People tend to take care of the land. It makes the community look better. You know, it's...
Yeah, I just want to go back. I don't think brush is a bad thing. It's sometimes good for wetlands, for, you know, all kinds of other erosion control and birds and wildlife.
I know.
Just because it looks messy to you, it looks great to me.
I understand that, and I, you know, everybody has the difference of opinions. But you know, on the other hand, you know, between Ebola and the Zika virus and all the equine encephalitis or whatever, you know, keep bringing these wetlands in more and more, and we'll, you know, the mosquitoes will win out and we won't. You know, I don't know.
Our water will be cleaner, and that's what we're all going to need for the next. Anyway.
Another thought that I had, John, real quick, if you don't mind.
Please.
Reducing the size of lots and planned developments and leaving regular A&R lots alone. I think that would be because with A&R, Massachusetts is the only, there are actually only two states, if I'm correct. I'm pretty sure that's what I heard. two states that allow A&R. And A&R lots can do a lot of damage.
I don't know what you mean by the A&R.
Where you live on a street,
yeah, yeah.
And you have the dimensional requirements, you can build a house without any oversight. That can do a lot of damage in particular areas that put a lot of houses in one section. Most other states do not allow A&R lots. It's Massachusetts and one other. In planned developments, that's a different story, I think, because you know you're planning. There's oversight. There's things that are being addressed ahead of time. You know, as far as septics and the layout of the home, because you're building the street to the homes, not the homes to the street.
Right.
I think this one
that we just approved tonight looked like they could have had several.
Well, they left space to give other right? lots.
You know,
said,
I think
yeah.
that's what you're saying is it's no people can come and get A&Rs if you have
right.
street
well,
frontage,
yeah,
man. You can just boom, 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 boom.
Right, exactly. Well, like with Kara's thing there, you know, they actually went over and above what
yeah.
was required.
An acre,
frontage.
Well, almost an acre mm-hmm. and a half there for that.
That's what's required there, though.
Well, it's 60, and they did 63 or 64, and they did 225 instead of just 200.
You know, the big thing that I would like to emphasize this too is that no matter how any of us feel about this, we can't change it.
Right.
All I'm saying is that as a board, I feel it's our responsibility because people have been asking about it, to work it out and put it in front of the town.
You say people had asked about it. You said, okay, the building inspector, mm-hmm. Dick never came to anybody here prior. Did Dick ever come to anybody? No, okay. And who are the other people?
It's just other people that I know. And it's not just recently. It's from times past.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I don't... What's the downside of changing it?
So did you say anything about frontage at this... I'm sorry.
Yeah, it should be reduced. I think it should be reduced from 200 to 150.
And that...
Why?
For the same reasons, or
it just makes proportion. It makes the lot square. Here again, this is I just brought this as a visual thing. These are 125 by 200, and you know every home on here is about 2,000 square feet. Some a little bigger. They all fit really good. They all look good. Everybody takes care of them nice.
I think because the next section of the bylaws after dimension is the rate of development, and I think this kind of gets into the rate of development now. It's funny because back in 2004, they said they didn't want to have more than 24 dwellings built per year.
We haven't had 24 buildings.
I was
going to
say, so I don't know who was yeah. what they were thinking back.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It was a fear thing.
Well, that's probably back when they put all those condos up in Mill Village and over there by
yeah, but they would
the
have been
all that. That
they
was
would
back
have been
then.
Planned development units.
Yeah.
So they would have gone under.
But
well, I don't know.
Still
actually,
building permits. And that's what they were talking
right.
about.
The laws were changed in the mid to late 80s because there was a problem.
What
that problem has been curbed.
Because of the...
Too much development, developers pushing the envelope constantly. I mean, why Kip, you know
just,
this.
No, tell me. I don't know this. I don't know this.
You know this. We haven't had any problems in Deerfield as far as these issues come up in the last... 10, 15, 20 years. Do we want to create an issue? What are the actual macroeconomics if this is being done, going backwards, shrinking lots from what they are now?
It's not going backwards. It's promoting growth. And we never even were in the boom time. I mean, at the time when some developers were building, I think, 20 and 30 units over here, I was in Amherst and Hadley building 200 and 300 units. And then I have friends that were down south building 2,000 and 3,000 units.
Well, that's great.
But what I'm saying is
what
that
do you want your town to look like?
I want the town to be able to grow steadily. And this would help do that. And there's enough people out there. I've heard it. I've heard from, I'm trying to be careful what I say. Enough people have expressed concern about the cost of building and that land is difficult to come by in Deerfield. That's affordable. You know, it's either you buy a lot and you spend a lot or you don't seem to get it, you know?
So just subdivisions would still have you could have different requirements for subdivisions, because that's partly what I think we're talking about.
That's where I'm going with this. I mean, I wouldn't be opposed to that.
Subdivisions might have certain regulations that are different than regular RA district, right?
Right, but then you're taking the process out of the realm of individuals, and you're exactly. creating something that's only available to real estate developers. You know, a plan. No one individual has that I know of has the resources to do the whole subdivision plan. And
right.
So, making it
give more flexibility to individual who just want to build right. a home. That's great, because I think we want to, I guess, encourage that. I don't know. That's something that the townspeople can talk about. But
right. I just, you know, if
but the process.
But if someone wanted to come in and take 20 acres and make as many houses as possible, they still have to go through the subdivision
right.
regulations.
And,
so that's what I'm saying.
I think there's a need for smaller lots in the A&R realm.
So this is going to only affect RA, water. Correct?
Right. Well, it's,
and so if you're only affecting the RA, if somebody has 200 feet, which is the frontage, right? Mm-hmm. Then you'd have to have somebody combine lots and do things to make them fit in existing areas, unless you've got a long stretch of frontage that's not built on.
Or right, or right. it's next to a 200-foot lot. You could put a 150-foot lot in.
An example like these people that were here tonight. I mean, they have a lot that has 200-foot frontage. You know, do they? If they wanted it, that's fine. But did they need it? You know, who knows? You know, this was a different situation because uh-huh. it was within the family.
Right.
But a lot of times there's people that that's not the case, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when
200-foot lots turn into 450-foot lots.
Yeah.
You know, you gain a lot every fourth lot.
Yeah.
So
because of frontage.
By cutting the frontage from 200 yeah. to 150,
right.
you but get with, four lots.
So then that you lose that. You lose
you
that.
You only get
that
three lots.
Lot size.
How does that affect the character of the town? Quite a bit, if you ask me.
25%. You know,
of having smaller frontage or having more houses. What are you?
The frontage and having houses. You know, we're in a farm community. We're trying. I'm trying to maintain the character of a farm community.
But that's, and if this you go, promotes that. It doesn't. Just if I say anything,
I disagree with you, because then all you see is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 houses, and who sees the backland?
Farmers get to use it.
Well, he's saying that the farmers actually benefit potentially
from could have
it.
That could have happened all along Mill Village Road. But because of our requirements.
You use the number, a farmer would have gained 5 acres by that, what I'm looking at right there. How do you come up with 5 acres? 20,000 square feet times 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lots, that's 1 acre.
How many square feet in an acre?
43, 5, 6.
You're right. This is 25. We require 60. So this particular lot saved almost 40,000 square feet.
Oh, right,
this particular one.
From 60 to 25, right?
Right.
So now we're saying 60 to 40, you don't save quite as much.
But I'm just showing them here. Yeah. So this one here would have saved 5 acres of land. Hmm. This does save 5 acres of backland, where if you had to have it bigger, it would just push back into it. You know what I'm saying?
I'd really like to take a ride with everyone. I
don't think that's going to happen.
But I guess my other...
Because you don't want the facts.
Well, that's not true.
Well, I think all of us can do our own reconnaissance and research. And,
That's what I suggested, the Google Map. I mean, that's a great tool. You can see everybody. You can see in their backyards. You can see their pools.
You don't see the topography.
No, you don't, but... If you want to take a good look there, then ride around, you can. I mean, I've been around. I don't need to. I mean, I'll more than happy to participate and go with you guys, but I know all these streets, and I think you do too. And I'm sure Max does, and I'm sure Paul does. John's the only one that might not have had the experience to drive around all these streets.
Why do you say that?
I just don't think that you're the kind of guy drives around the streets looking places.
I actually ride my bike a lot, but...
Oh, well, okay. Well, then...
Might have seen more of the lots than...
Maybe. I don't know. That's why I said maybe.
I think
that
was just an unusual...
But anyways, I think that I know it well. And I think Max knows it well, and I think you know it well. But...
Is there this much property out there that would be able to be subdivided? Not subdivided, but cut into these lots?
and have the frontage on the roads. I mean, we did a lot of studying on affordable housing only to find out that, well, maybe we didn't even have the land to do that with, you know what I mean? Or the
right.
Or make
this,
it reasonable.
This is one of those things, too, unless we're not trying to get the town into it, that I feel strongly about bringing this and let the people make the choice. And I don't see what the problem is, because regardless of our personal feelings, we don't make that decision. We just arrange it and say, look, this is out there. What do you think? If you like it, vote for it. If you don't, vote against it.
And I think the questions from people will be like, what's changed since we did the laws? And we've talked about some of these things. And then I think the other thing, you know, who benefits and who doesn't? So anybody, current homeowner that has their 60,000 square feet, 200 frontage, it's not going to mean anything to personally them, to right. them.
But most people our age have children and maybe have grandchildren. And they, you know, as much as I love my kids, you know, I booted them to the curb when they got to be a certain age. And, you know, you need to go out and find your own place. And everybody else is the same way. And things just keep getting more and more expensive. And, you know,
I'm saying I can't take my 200 foot frontage and divide it in half and give half of it to my son now, my daughter. I can't.
No, you're right. And you can't. And I
so it's
get
the
that.
People who have larger lots of land who are going to benefit from this.
Yes, could be.
And someone's going to ask you, what's your stake in this, and how many extra lots are you going to get out of this?
Well, it's
I just
funny.
Think you should be prepared for that.
Yeah, that's okay. I mean, when I bought my land 30 years ago, the rumors around, we watched the condos grow. And the only thing I built there is a barn.
So, well, it seems a little bit coincidental that you're here doing this now, because it was you that brought this to the forefront.
Yeah, well,
you have every right in the world to do.
That's right. Yeah. And it's because people want a choice. They don't like the fact that people on boards tell them what to do.
I think when you say people, I just, in my mind, I'm also thinking developers, people who build houses have one thought. People who are living here already might have another. And I think you're right. We should put it out there to the people. But
that is true.
There is a difference.
And
there is
the
people who are going to make money off it,
but
and other people who...
I was a builder. I am a builder. And that, you know, it isn't that I don't look at when I build houses. Like when I built six houses up here, I didn't look at I was wrecking the farmland. This land was for sale and it was going to be sold. Mm-hmm. But you know what? There's six families that grew up there, yeah. Multiple generations now. Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, it gave them a place to live. Yeah. And, it's all about choice. I built some duplex homes over where John lives. The people chose to turn them back into a single family. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was their choice. They had, you know, it. Just because you build a two-family doesn't make that it's always going to be a two-family. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, people's needs change all the time. And our economic environment has changed dramatically over the last 10 years, and especially since these rules have changed. You know, I don't understand why they made such a dramatic change, but they did.
Well, looking at some of the guidelines from other towns, I mean, we're right there, right in the middle of everybody else. I mean, there's some towns that have exactly what we do. There are some towns that have more than we do. In fact, I found it interesting, the town of Whately has two residential districts, and I'm not sure, I didn't have time to talk to anybody from Whately about it, but there's two residential districts, so it must be, my guess is one's a mountain district and one's a flatland district. And in the larger of the two districts, I think it was 80,000 square feet for a building lot. So, you know, so we're not off base from where everybody else is.
You know, and I've done a lot of research on that, John, and that, you know, I can't speak for why different communities pick and choose some of the things, but I'll give you some extreme examples. You talk about Whately. Now, Whately has a very similar 60,000 square foot thing, but they also allow, you can have 50 feet of frontage and then go back to a large piece of land. We don't allow stuff like that. In Montague, where, you know, I have no water and sewer, I only need 1 acre, and yet you go right down the road where it's sandy and you only need a quarter of an acre. And then you go to Granby, where they have a lot of tight soils and stuff like that, and they have 4 acres. You know, so it really changes a lot. And here in Deerfield, we have the same thing. We have some areas of town that's very sandy and gravelly, and we have other places that has a lot of clay and silt. And in that, I thought that, you know, changing the size of the lot when you have no water, no town water, no snow, it makes sense to leave it larger. But when you have one or the other, it makes a lot of sense to make it smaller.
So I'd like to just
I got a question for you, Kip. In the town of Deerfield, would you say that there's basically the same drainage for septic tanks all over town, or are there? Is it varied?
Totally different.
Okay, yeah. So you know, maybe we should approach this as if somebody's got a land that perks well and they have water or sewer, you know what I mean?
I think that would be a permit that they could come in and take. You're just getting that, you're muddying the waters, because there's a different thing. The perk test deals with that whole thing. And, you know, there's rules and stuff. If it's that tight where it won't perk, you're not going to build anyways. And if it's a little bit tight, well, then your field grows. If it's real sandy, matter of fact, you know, a septic system, you know, this would kind of got me into this. When you have septic systems that are in sand, it's actually worse for the environment than when it's in a type of clay.
Because of
it just goes right through. It doesn't filter as good as it should.
Yeah.
But
so to move this conversation along, I would say, I forget when town meetings, usually May or?
Yeah, the beginning of May, end of April.
Sometimes it's, Pat Smith always likes to work backwards, so then and you need a public hearing. But I guess I would propose that you write up some of these things you just mentioned there. You've got it written up.
Yeah.
And then I feel like we sort of should put out the pros and cons or pros. You know, why are we bringing this forward? And then this is February, so then our March meeting we can continue it here, and then in April have a public hearing.
So if I could just, in my mind, I was thinking as you're talking, when you're saying either sewer or water, in RA, you're not going to have sewer. You're only going to have town water.
Correct.
So the sewer is not even an issue there. I mean, as far as an exception to the thing.
Correct.
So it's just if they've got town water. And how far does town water go out into the RA district?
It goes all the way up on Lower Road, has it for quite a while. Quite a ways.
Goes all the way up to Lower Road?
Mm-hmm.
Or does that come off of Deerfield?
Deerfield, but it's still
Lower Road. It loops.
It's what?
There's water on Lower Road.
Okay.
There's water
pretty much
all the way up
Upper Road, Road, still water.
Upper Road, there's no water.
There's no water on Upper Road.
It just crosses the bridge. Or I think it back feeds across under 91.
The Lower Road has water the whole way?
Not all the way.
A
portion.
Out to Savages?
Oh, past there.
Past there?
Basically, where you see hydrants, you know that's that's where the water, and that's where I know it ends on 5 and 10.
And then how about going up 116? How much water is there up there?
All the way to Conway Line, pretty much.
Is it? Okay. I don't know. I'm just curious.
It runs out Stillwater Road.
You know, if I remember correctly, the FERCOG can actually show you a map with all the water lines
right,
from the town.
Like all the condos are on town water.
So that was the other thing I was going to ask. Is there some other research that we want someone like Pat Smith or someone to do?
Well, you know, to me, it'd be good to know where's the property that could be affected by this, and then what is the available?
Well, we have a water map somewhere here?
No, I'm saying that there's a water map that exists at the.
I know. I'm thinking
the FERCOG has it in their database, so they can actually sit down and draw you maps that show you the water.
I mean, you could take places like.
All right, but we're starting to get into new things. Does that make sense that we do next month we look at language here and we start to look at what other things we want to investigate and then we get it out to a public hearing at some point?
Well, couldn't we do that now and maybe have a public hearing with our next meeting? I mean,
because a public hearing, you need to have the language introduce certain language and then have the public hearing say yes or no or comment on that specific language, and I don't think we're there yet.
It's only change a couple numbers in one sentence.
Well, I guess the other
not a big deal, you know.
Well, the other quick thing I would like to say is, if we're going to make any other zoning changes, we should do. If there's some we're waiting to do, let's do them all together. Because every time you redo this thing, it's like all these
votes
and public hearings, and it costs a lot of money, and this and that. The other thing is that self storage, which I thought we had almost some language ready to go on that one. So can you do that? Write it up, send it around to all of us and to Pat.
Sure.
And she can put it into zoning language.
Yeah, I really think it could be as simple as that. Just change that number and add a 9 and add a, put that
paragraph. Right, we got enough other little...
Don't you have to change the use chart?
Don't you have to change that?
No, they're using them.
We're not going to change anything. Just that, go from 60,000 to 40 and from 200 to 150. And here again, I don't know if it's going to work. It's not my decision.
Yeah, it may not have anybody come and take up on it.
People don't think that's a good idea, you know?
Well, the thing is, I'd like to have is enough reasons to let people know what should they be considering when they're thinking about it. Most people aren't going to be like, oh, I don't know. So what is it, what should they be considering when they're, before they vote on it, I guess?
Well, my gut feeling is with the building that's here, I don't think it's going to increase the building real quick. It may be something down the road or whatever.
Right.
It's not going to be an immediate thing, but it's a step in one direction. You know what I mean?
As it goes, you know, it definitely will make it easier for people to get it. And I don't know this, but there could be parcels of land out there that, you know, don't meet the current requirements.
Mm-hmm,
that, you
mm-hmm.
know, maybe this guy's got a piece of land and his daughter wants this.
I just don't think changing your lot sizes and frontages like changing underwear is the appropriate thing to do.
Well, that's your opinion, and I respect that. But it's not your choice. It's not my choice.
I didn't say it was. I'm just offering my opinion.
But we haven't done it in a while, right?
But the last time we did it, it was because there was problems with the lot sizes that we had. So
the world has changed a lot. You need to bring that back, right, though, and see are those still issues still relevant?
Right.
Or
you know,
not?
Time has gone by. Yeah. People forgot why they voted for what.
Absolutely.
They did.
Or have
things changed so it's not as important as it was?
Yeah.
I would argue that it's probably more important than it was.
Okay. So that's what I haven't heard, I guess, enough of.
Yeah.
I think that's what people need to understand.
Now, what were your pluses and your minuses you were doing there? I'll put them in the minutes if you want.
It's hard to do plus and the minus because a plus to one person might be a minus to another. So it's really just like what are some of the issues that are going to...
Sure.
I mean, in the end, it has to be what's best. You have to look at the town of Deerfield as a living, breathing organism.
The whole town.
You know, the actual town itself, the land and
because if it's good for 10 individuals, well, that's nice for them. But if it's not really good for the overall town for the long term, then that's not something that, I mean, yeah, that's what planning is about.
I can say this sounds like a fairly minor change compared to what that affordable housing was going to do. That was going to be massive changes in the, well,
I don't know what those are.
It was going to make cluster housing. It was going to do all kinds of stuff that was...
Well, I think there were also a lot of not facts brought up in.
No. I was involved with that pretty heavily. They were going to take streets and then put short frontage and small lots up a street just so that you can get a whole bunch of houses in there. And they were going to have, 12 family units in places. And so it was a significant change.
Again, those are subdivisions,
change.
Right?
They're subdivisions.
That comes under another site plan. And
I agree with you.
The big picture here to also keep in the back of your mind is, I don't think it was going to happen, but one of the big reasons that we bought the Oxford property was supposedly to stop a certain type of housing project coming in. And what was true then is still true today. Someone could come and approach me for my 25 acres of land and put up 110 units of housing and never come here, never come to this board. Never even get a building permit.
Yeah, that's a real process.
Not even a building permit. They don't even have to follow the building code. How do you like that?
No, that's
that's 40B.
You got to follow HUD's regulations.
All right, so you're following somebody's.
But not ours.
Yeah. Urban stuff.
But yeah. they scare a lot of towns with that, but it's not so easy to do. I mean, when you have a
John, and I agree with that, and that's why I was opposed to the purchase of the Oxford property. But it is a reality, you know. And I think any time that we can make things easier for people, and primarily it's going to be us local people that are going to benefit from it. It's going to be you know, my children, my grandchildren, and your children, you know. Those are primary people. You know, yeah, you're going to get people that come in from the outside, but you know, it's from within. That's who we're really trying to help.
You know,
what's the matter with people from the outside?
I'm just saying you still will get people from the outside, but I'm saying it's primarily going to be, you know, our next generation of home buyers that are going to be looking for it.
Right,
if they want to
stay in their hometown.
Does anybody know if it's ever been discussed in the town of Deerfield, like what they do out west, the Colorado, where pretty much
the developments are all tightly knit, close together, and all the land is, you know, all the backland, the open space is saved.
You got a whole different thing out there. When you get out into those states, because I lived in Arizona, this land that's county land and not town land, there's land out there that's not in a town or a city. It's out in the middle of nowhere. It's in the county. So
but
that's
if I'm not mistaken,
situation.
They do a lot of that in Europe too, where you know
they bring infrastructure there.
And but what bring infrastructure there, and you know you're talking, you know, half acre lots. I mean, over there they're garden
right.
homes.
But one of the problems that you can't do so much of that here in New England is because of all of our rules and regulations and the expense. What happens in big projects like you might see in Arizona or down south is that, you know, we come in and we're going to build, you know, 1,000 homes. Well, Paul does nothing but dig a hole. You do nothing but do the footings. You do nothing but build, you know, the front walls. I do the back walls. And everybody has their own little specialty, and it's like almost like a no-brainer. You don't really have to be a builder. All you have to do is know your one job. It's like a machine. And it becomes very inexpensive to process the product. And because of the lack of regulations and rules and stuff like that, they don't take months on end to do the things that we do. They go in, this is what we want to do, okay, go for it. And when you back out, you see the results. And only when I had good friends of mine move to South Carolina, I was always under the notion, well, yeah, okay, it's easier to build down there and this and that. And but what do you have? I mean, look what the schools do. See the stuff they got down there. We talk about our highway garage being the Taj Mahal. They've got schools, they got hospitals, they got youth centers, all this stuff. It's like, how in that? It's because of the house after house after house after house.
Yeah.
And their taxes,
all right. So I'm gonna,
they have a $500,000 house, they pay $800 tax.
Bring us back to the agenda here. So, all right, so we've had a lot of discussion, so we'll continue it, and we'll start working on proposed language next time, because you need to have proposed language before a hearing.
Okay.
And then we could go.
So there's two things we're going to be looking at. One is what Kip is talking about, and the other was the rezoning for the storage units.
Well, why don't I propose this? Why don't each of us look over that use table in the next month and just come up with two things that we thought might be handy in it? Mm. And that way, then we can talk about it. I'd hate to think that we're doing this just for one thing in one spot, you know?
I'm trying to think even what it fit under.
Is this guy with the housing? I think when I saw the thing, I didn't recognize the name. Is he the same guy that wanted to come in before?
I believe so.
I don't think that matters, but why?
It doesn't.
I was just curious.
So now we're on to storage, correct?
Yeah, I just wanted to see where that fit, because was it that we were going to add a line item or we were going to change something that already existed? I think we don't have a...
Well, I think there was two zones suggested, wasn't there? Was it the...
RA with water and RA without water.
I think we skipped by that. Hmm? We're talking about the.
That's for your.
I thought it was C2 and.
But now we're talking that.
Industrial or.
Self-storage.
Self-storage.
I think we just didn't. We don't have a principal use that it fit under, and I don't know where we were trying to fit it.
Why can't we just add another line?
Well, that's what I'm thinking we need to do.
Well, C2 is. That's in the center of town, right? That's in our CVR district, more
right.
or less.
Right.
Do we want to see
storage
units in that
okay.
district?
So self-storage warehouse is under industrial. I forgot. I was looking under commercial.
Yep.
But it's considered industrial, and self-storage, it's no everywhere except a special permit in planned industrial.
Okay.
Be
perfect. I wonder if it would be a good...
That's your...
The industrial park.
Right.
Industrial park.
That's so the question is...
The park's gone now.
Yeah.
The question is, do we want to make it a special permit somewhere else? I think that's the question.
I wonder if all that land that's behind North Main Street would be a good place if you had an ability to get it right away back there.
Sidderley came to us.
What's that?
Sidderley came to us asking about this same question.
Siddeley did for home for
well,
storage.
Back when they were talking about doing the water.
Yeah, but that was something different. Yeah. That wasn't like these little garages that are all lined up. You know,
well, that's
what's that
industrial back there by Hardig's.
That whole strip up there. That's all. You know, yeah. if we change zoning up there, that could be utilized if we get ability to not have to have the frontage there and have an access to the, you know, out to the. To North Main Street. I don't know. Just a thought.
I don't think, if you go the route special permit in any district, I still think with special permit, it can't be denied. Correct? Am I correct with saying that?
No.
So.
No, that's not. That's, why would you? No.
No, okay.
Special permit means the special permitting board gets to review all the reasons why you want it or you don't want it.
So then should industrial C2 and C1 just be made by special permit?
That's kind of what I think we were wondering. EPD is where they wanted to do it.
Yeah.
Right? That's the Oxford property. And there's a no, so whether we want to... I think most people didn't think that was a good use there.
Right.
But industrial areas... I mean, the thing is, I think the reason why they wrote no here is because industrial areas should be a lot of jobs. Self-storage don't come with jobs, really. Right?
Well,
so that's why
not
they,
many,
that's
but
why
it
they
still
initially
does.
Initially yeah. They said no because they wanted like the industrial park. They wanted so many big manufacturers, and now it's different. Things have changed.
Mm-hmm.
C2, C1. That's where are those zones? Are they it's like along 5 and 10?
Along 5 and 10 is C1.
So the question is that what you want on 5 and 10? You know, that you start to get into those discussions.
Well, you know, there's all that the Douglas stuff up there, the gables and all that, too, I suppose.
Right, self-storage warehouse doesn't take water and sewer, probably. You don't have to do too much. Maybe you have to have one restroom there. I don't know what you're required, but
yeah.
So maybe that's a good use of a place that doesn't have.
But it's also tax. It's also tax money, you know. There's not much burden on the town's resources to have another business in town.
Yeah, that's true.
Although self-storage warehouses, you'll hear from different police departments around saying some cause more problems, some don't. I don't know. I've just heard that. I know that some places have been.
Yeah. I
but
guess.
Still, I think generally it's considered those kind of businesses is like 70% of the tax dollars is what it costs us. You know, in other words, there's more profit
right.
for the town.
Right. All right. So let's. I don't know if do we need more discussion? Do we need more research? What do we need to determine if we want to change some of those to SPs?
Here again, we don't change that.
Mm-hmm. For us to propose it.
Yeah.
I think it's a no-brainer. Just ask
yeah,
the people.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it's just.
Right, but you got to propose something. So you want to propose SPs everywhere and then see what people say? Or?
Oh, why don't we just say in the C1 and C2?
And industrial or?
Well, there's only one spot of industrial that's not in the industrial park, right? And then we've got the EPD.
There's land that's over here on North Main Street that abuts Hardig's to the south.
Where the lady kept her.
Yep. There's land there.
Yeah, and the questions that would arise with that is, you know, if somebody came, not that it's a bad spot, but the increased traffic load up North Main Street, that would be one of the first questions. Who's out there? Because it's, you know, so there will be questions.
I'm sure there will be.
But most of those places do have hours.
Yeah, and they're not open 24/7.
And they are gated.
Yep.
And we can set those, too.
Sure.
We can put that kind
But, again, is it up to us to offer a spot for...
No, then that's why I'm saying no. I would never want
but
to do
tell you
that.
that's a big thing around here. I mean, I know a lot of people that have them, and they travel out of town to go and do it. You know.
You know, and in the big picture, I mean, if we had this in town, and this is just hypothetical. Let's just say there were 30 people in town that have to drive to Amherst to self storage.
Yeah.
Okay, and they go there twice a month. How many hundreds of gallons of gas would they save?
Exactly.
How much air pollution? You know, talk about global warming. I mean, our society is great for having somebody go here and there and here and there. And
you read that thing in the paper today about the solar and how much it cost, how much pollution the solar and all that stuff costs and the everything.
It was in the paper today, in the editorial section.
No, it wasn't an editorial. It was a letter from someone who had no...
That's the editorial
did
page.
No research on it. And just, yeah. It was amazing that people can spew out whatever they
want. Oh, I know.
In a letter to the editor, and they publish it.
Yeah.
It totally...
Well, that stuff rang true with me, though.
Oh, check it out, though. It's not at all... When you look at the...
That's all right. It's not a planning board thing.
I noticed that this morning. It pissed me off. So there's the other one in here that... anybody can write a letter to the paper and people read it and thinking it's fact. Well, so no, there's the other section in here that says something about how you can override our zoning. Remember the thing that... Who used that? So there... It was in here and it said...
That was some A&Rs that Dan Werner brought in, I think, that you were talking about. And that was when, like Chet Yaswinski, when they set up their stuff and they didn't meet all the requirements.
Are you talking the pre-zoning, two buildings or more on a property?
I'm trying to remember what it was, but it had to do with Pekarsky's and with and Yaswinski's. Those two guys took advantage of that.
Right, I'm trying to figure out.
I'm trying to remember what it was.
John's going with this, though.
There was something else in here. We all talked about it. We wanted to change it.
That's the variance in the commercial district, right?
Yeah, variance. Maybe that was it. It made it like so easy to get a variance.
And because in the commercial district, it says that variances are allowed in residential, but it said nothing.
Right.
About commercial or industrial, therefore by default,
right,
they were allowed to change the zoning there or go in front of the zoning board. Is that
right? And so I think it was the language left it open, and I don't think that was what people meant when they put it down.
Right. I think that maybe Pat Smith
she wanted to.
What's this pertaining to, John?
Was it the Yaswinski and the Pekarsky?
No.
Because that was commercial and residential.
Where's the thing about variances? Yeah, you're right. I think it was about variances. All right, I'll find it though. But that's another thing that we might want to change while we're doing this. All right, what else we got going on?
So well, I'll work on this. I'll talk to Pat Smith about it. We can discuss it at our next meeting.
Yeah, if you can come up with language. And like I say, I think it's good, worthwhile for us to say why we're bringing it forward.
Yep.
You're right. People can decide, but we should have.
Yep.
And then the same with the self-storage. We'll do the language for the SPs in those couple zones.
So if we do that, do you have a problem with potentially setting up a... public hearing in the middle of March?
I like personally having public hearings during our meetings, but...
Well, that would postpone it till April, or then it would be too late for the town meeting.
When's the town meeting? Do we know?
April 27th.
Oh, really? Yeah. All right, then maybe we do need to. Again, if it's a rush or not, I mean, it's not...
Well,
urgent, but it's not something we should just keep putting off either.
Not a rush, but I mean, if we don't do something, it will end up being a year like other things, John. I mean, it's just like the self-sourcing. We were talking about this last summer, and
it gets
pushed off to the side. And
okay. All right, so let's potentially do that. Yeah.
I've mentioned a few times, John, about the height restrictions, and I don't know if that's something anybody wants to...
I think it's a good point. I think we should readjust that as well.
Because I did talk to...
It was a fire thing, was it?
Yeah, I talked to Bill Swayze, Chief of the Fire, and Dennis Patterson. I'm not quite sure what his role is. He's like second in charge over at the fire department, and they didn't have any issues with it because of the ladder truck, and they, you know, basically write up the language and let us see what it says, and we'll... either say, yeah, it's okay with us, or, you know, obviously you'd have the police department's input.
Because the other EPD, which is the latest thing that we added, that has 48 feet. All the other ones are 35 feet in height.
35 or 36, is that?
They're 35 currently.
They're 35. Yeah.
But then we did the EPD 48, because maybe the fire department said... Now it's not a fire issue. I don't know why.
Right. So 12 feet to a story. So if you have 35, that's that's not even quite a full story then to 48.
But I would think you would want to.
Well, then, should we? Is that just for industrial and commercial, or are you talking across the board? Or?
Well, I mean, we. What does everybody think on that? I just think if we have the ability to do that and reduce, potentially reduce
footprint
I think it's
environmental. And no one's talking about the other side and rear and all 10 and 25 for some things, and seems to be working for people.
Yep.
All right. All right, let's look through some mail. We got some mail here. Can you, I don't know, some of them are opened, I guess. Mostly from on the planning board.
How do you spell Mylar?
M-Y-L-A-R.
Okay, I keep getting a red line under that.
Oh, that's...
So, okay.
That's where it's called.
And this right, you can see the spell check.
So I do want to, say that we sent a letter, since our last meeting, we sent a letter to Lake Street Development Partners with a bill that included what we got charged for COGS, and Lake Street Development Partners paid the full bill of $5,080.92, and that does then go into our revolving fund, as you talked about. We also last month didn't ask for an increase in our annual budget, so that's a good thing, and now we do have some money in our
revolving. We need to apply that money to her
budget
bill.
If we need to.
I think that
you're right. Yeah.
John, was that bill for $8,100 from all of the work that she did, included the work for Lake Street?
Right. So there was other stuff that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that was a good. Appreciate. Many people on here.
Yeah.
Said let's send them a bill, and we did, and it worked.
Well, it puts it in our front of our mind for the next project to make sure that we.
Yeah, it does.
Consider the, you know, if we're using, the FERCOG that we. Keep better track of that.
So then I think we got some mail that we should all know about from a dear planning board members, and this comes from one of our members, John Baronis, and it regards a copy of a formal request for appointment of counsel. I'm not sure I saw this letter. Please find enclosed the letter I sent to the town of Deerfield's Finance Committee regarding the complaint I filed, along with my request that counsel be appointed as allowed by statute. So this actually, does this follow the other letter? Did you send a letter to the planning board informing us what you were doing?
Yes. Okay.
Why don't you give me the...
On December 17th, I attended a ZBA hearing for a frontage variance request by Hank Zukowski. I went there as a neighbor, but more importantly, as a personal member of the planning board, because I think that the zoning board needs to follow our rules and regulations. There's specific criteria that needs to be met for variances to be issued. I stood up and I gave them enough information. With that information alone, that should have been enough to at least bare minimum, continue the hearing to get more information. It was about a self-created hardship for a frontage relief at Mr. Zukowski's property. The current zoning, as you know, is 200 feet. 10 years ago, Mr. Zukowski divided up his frontage on his farmland, and there's five homes that were built. And you know, his daughter Barbara's, I include in that also, so it's 4 plus 1. And that's where I come off with the A&R lots. They can do a lot of damage. In those 10 years, the watershed has changed, dumping much more water over onto the other side of the road, onto my side of the road. I believe that the preload has changed the underground hydrology, because in that 10-year period, apple trees on the neighbor's land have started to die. The sedges have increased. I'm just stating facts. It's fact. Just I have no scientific data. However, I've been there for 50 years. I watch what goes on. And also the people that mow the hay across the street seem to be able, you know, it's less and less they can mow, and it's wetter and wetter. Coincidental that this happened. So now with this last lot, well, let me back up a little bit. The other thing brought up was, even if that variance were granted, I do not believe that it qualifies as a building lot, because with a 200-foot setback from the Wetlands Protection Act, that will bring the usable highland lot size down to, and I'm estimating, down to about 20,000 square feet, whereas right now we require 80% of 60,000 square feet, or about an acre. The board really didn't hear me. There was very, very little discussion, and they voted unanimously in a heartbeat to grant the variance. I look at this as a planning board member. Why are we here? If the laws that we present to the people, voted two-thirds by the people, are just overturned. I mean, we as a township, our local government is the last thing left that hopefully lacks corruption. When we see day by day the Constitution being shredded, you know, we have to start somewhere. I look at it like this. If I sit there watching you steal my chickens, eventually I'll let you rape my daughters. And I just, that's how strong I feel about it. So, Chapter 40A, Section 17, states that an officer of the town may request independent legal counsel to proceed. I am going to be asking for a vote from the planning board, either support or not support. I'm actually going to hold off on asking for that vote tonight. I'd rather wait till we have a full deck here, so I'll bring this up in February. But that's what the letter is all about.
Why didn't you just bring it to the selectmen? They appointed the ZBA.
There's nothing that can be done once that vote is taken. It's unfortunate, but this is the route that has to go.
To appeal that decision.
To appeal this decision. It's, and an appeal is a big deal. It's not just, you know, hey, you know, we don't like your decision. It's a big deal.
I'm just...
But if you feel that strongly about it, why do you want the town to pay for it?
Because they... I'm asking for independent legal counsel because they did not follow the rules of the state or the town. This is a checks and balances. We are the only other town elected board that has anything to do with policy of the town. There is the...
But if in fact what you say is true, then you should be able to go to the combination of the Ethics Commission and the Attorney General and say didn't follow the proper procedures.
No, this is the only way to do it.
So, I see two issues. So what he's doing is he filed an appeal, because that's the only way you can stop a ZBA decision. You get 20 days, 21 days?
20 days.
So within that time period, he filed an appeal with the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Department of the Superior Court, and that is apparently the only way you can...
It is the only way.
To overturn a decision. So, yeah. And just on the larger issue, because I talked to John in between this, and it did raise concerns that the ZBA makes decisions that are against what some of the bylaws that we help bring forward and that we help uphold. So that's
I
thought that at some point the planning board and the ZBA should probably get together on this issue about, like, I don't know, are they doing this all the time? We don't know.
Well, I mean, so, a very similar situation happened at town meeting a couple years ago with that property I was just talking about over there, where the town created spot zoning in allowing this person to do it. Yep. I didn't agree with it, but you know what? That's what the town did, and that's what they wanted, and you know, I...
But that's quite a open, transparent town meeting. It's a lot different than a ZBA meeting when there's just a few people there and usually no audience, you know.
But I watched it on television, and I, you know, I mean, it was televised. Everybody had a right to go. John went, of course. And,
So there's that issue that we should maybe go back and look and see, is there a lot of variances
I've just,
and special
I've just
permits?
Seen
but
that.
Then on this particular issue, this one is actually now under appeal. And as John stated, there's a provisions that... Now, the question I have is he doing this appeal as a planning board member or as a resident of the town?
I am doing it as an officer of the town.
Okay. And so you did it without talking to us about it. So I guess that's my question is that mean that the planning board is now appealing the ZBA decision?
Or no,
is it still you as an individual?
It's still me as an individual.
Yep. All right.
But I would, you know, I'm going to be asking for your support, not to...
And then has
something that you need support from our board to do this, or is this something you have the right to do just by yourself?
Oh, I don't have to have your support. I would like your support.
No, I mean, I'm just trying to decide this, to understand the process, whether it's required or not. And
oh, no, it's not required, no.
Okay.
But I will be asking for your support, but I'm not going to ask for your support tonight.
And why did you have to get the Finance Committee to... Do they have to agree to
the Finance Committee is
the only
entity in town that can release funds to do this.
Interesting.
What about all those motions at town meeting that say to appropriate or for the select board? Select board can't write the checks.
No, it's the Finance Committee that releases the money.
And then where
this
does
is
the,
what this is. I'm going by my consultant's guidance.
I'm representing
myself right now. Pro se.
Does the money come out of the planning board's budget then?
With a consultant.
No, what he's saying, it would come out of the Finance Committee.
But still, the Finance Committee has to take it from somewhere, is my point, that's all.
Right.
Where would they be taking it from? Free cash, or would they have to figure someplace to take it from?
Yeah, I think that's
a selectman or whatever.
And I believe that language was specifically put in Chapter 17. For checks and balance purposes. I can see no other reason why that was put in there. So that's the scoop on that.
So John, you're saying the ZBA, you believe, did not have the authority to grant that variance because it violated our zoning bylaws?
Well, it was in direct conflict with town law.
Isn't that the whole purpose of a ZBA? Is a zoning board?
They have specific guidelines that they have to go by, mandated by the state, and they did not do that.
Did they hold a public hearing on it?
Well, yeah, there was a public whatever they have to do, like that. Yeah, but this is a self-created hardship. There was no reason for that to be granted.
Come up to the microphone, please.
Hank, this...
I don't know.
We're just reviewing the mail right now.
He was he had his moment during the public comments. This isn't a courtroom right here.
Right.
So I want to make that very clear.
So all we're being is, through the mail, we're being informed that this is going on.
Yes.
And at this point, there's no... what we have to take or anything. It's just information purposes.
So can we get a copy?
Absolutely, it's public record.
Okay. I don't, is anybody scan it? Is it emailable? I think I might have seen
it. We can ask email. Doug to do that.
Yeah, so let's ask, we can ask.
Yeah, Doug will make you copies.
Doug can make copies and send it to you. And then let's put it on our agenda for next meeting?
Sure. I appreciate that.
So then would you suggest this gentleman come back then, or what do you just...
So...
Is there any...
Yeah, because we're wrapping up the meeting, and so this was just informational purposes, but if you want to just say you want to be notified about what we do about it in the future, that would be fine. We can...
Well, definitely. I want to attend on that next meeting, definitely.
All right.
Now, I don't know if this is the proper forum for this or not, but there are...
What's your name? I'm sorry.
Hank Zukowski. I was the one that applied for the variance and was granted by the ZBA.
All right.
Now, I've got 178 feet of frontage.
So we really don't want to talk about that issue.
No, this comes into in conjunction with what Kip was saying about the 150 feet being enough.
Okay, but yeah, we've moved off of that topic. I really can't. We're going right now. We're going backwards if we get there.
I know, but still.
So we gotta. We will talk about that at the next meeting. So if you want to be here to talk about that, or if you want to talk about this appeal, we could do that at the next meeting. But I really can't go backwards at this point.
Okay, we'll be here.
So our next meeting, we're about to set it.
Yeah, and I don't think there needs to be any public discussion about this.
Well, public comment is always welcome. At the right time, and I did ask for the public comment earlier.
Okay.
Is that the letter? Is that the?
No, this is Town of Shelburne.
So, or something else. Okay.
The first Monday of
It says March 7th. Is that the first Monday?
Yeah, there's 29 days in this February, right. So it throws things off a little bit. Yeah. So for the first Monday, March 7th, can we set our next meeting for that? So we'll be doing that at 7 o'clock, and the agenda is always posted, and I think it's on the website. Supposed to be.
Good-okay.
All right. Thanks. Any other mail?
The Shelburne Zoning Board of Appeals will conduct a public hearing on February 4th, 2016 at 7:30 at Memorial Hall at the request of Kevin Parsons, representing Four Deerfield Avenue Realty Trust, 369 Main Street, Shelburne, Mass., to modify the original variance in order to remove the condition no residential use permitted and or zoning relief as required.
All right, I'm just looking for relevance still.
You know, okay, I just, you know.
No, I mean, it's.
Oh, by the way, I've learned a lot. These that we get from budding towns, that's by law.
Right, that's, and we send it to them too.
Right, that's I can't say we. I always thought it was
courtesy or something,
just a courtesy, but it's by law. Town of Montague Board of Appeals, I won't read the whole thing. It's about solar. That's another thing I think we need to bring up soon to revisit that.
I thought we had another solar request coming.
Well, we're going to see more and more, and I think we need to adjust.
Oh, I thought there might be something too, but there was
Olinar or somebody.
Yeah, the one Pioneer off Gardens. Of old
is that Pioneer Gardens?
Mill Village Road. Yes. Pioneer Gardens.
Yeah.
He came to the CONCOM.
Yeah.
And the CONCOM chair and I agreed that if we can do it together, that's great. They're going to do a determination. They call it something. It's like a determination if there's wetlands. So he's going to go forward to that. And if there isn't, then it's all on us. If it is, then they'll do some of the water issues around it.
Town of Waitley, a ZBA for a special permit to build a barn over somewhere in Waitley.
You get a lot of greenfield. Some existing service station wants to add a convenience store.
Planet.
Yeah, ZBA greenfield, and this is that the Planet Fitness or
Planet Gas.
Jim is looking to add parking spaces.
They want to what?
Cold storage.
Jim wants to add parking spaces.
Yeah,
up at their new place.
Wall Street greenfield cold storage unit.
So greenfield has an application for a solar photovoltaic system, 14 modules, 9 kilowatts, so that's not too big. If we do see another town getting a big, like a big solar, then we should sort of pay attention to it probably to see how they...
Well, yeah, I mean, when we did our solar bylaws, really, it was so new, we didn't know anything. You know, we just... And now that people are becoming more educated, I think we should probably ease up on some of the restrictions and or at least allow things more by special permit. And
then there's another one, Montague. Someone wants a special permit to convert a second unit to a two-family dwelling.
The letter?
Yes.
All right, so that's what we've got. Any other business?
I was at the Franklin planning meeting. Real quickly, there was discussion. Some scientists from UMass were in, and they've put together some documentation on Irene, the hurricane. There was some very interesting data that was brought forward, and it's scientific data. It's very true, and basically it had to do with the modeling of the modeling of the core samples taken out of rivers and ponds and et cetera, et cetera. And what made Irene so different was that it was slope erosion rather than lowland erosion. Irene in itself, and I'm not going to go on and on, but these are some of the real high points that, are interesting. Irene in itself wasn't any bigger than other big storms that we've had, 38, 36, whatever, 50, whatever. The big difference is that the ground was saturated. If it was a very rainy summer, and the ground just couldn't take it. And he showed a graph starting in 1970 that, I'm not gonna say it proves, but it shows that something is happening, that our rainfall is, it went from kind of flat all the way through the 1900s to almost vertical. So there is things going on in the atmosphere, in the world. It's probably, these storms are probably going to happen more often and more frequently is the bottom line. More devastating effect, yeah. Yes, correct.
Well, not that many years ago, this was a lake and there were dinosaurs here.
That's right.
We live on a living planet. Glacial lakes, it's going to change. 20,000, that's not that much.
So there is something going on, and the climate does change. Yep. That's all there is to it.
Yeah.
So you need to prepare as best you can.
And is it quicker because of human interaction?
And that's argued all the time, too. Yeah. Who knows?
I think most people know.
I don't think it's that clear cut, John, so you can't say
but
that.
But that's not on our agenda tonight.
Right. The other thing was the pipeline. It's turned into a huge fiasco. The corruption that's happening at different levels, the things that are being sold that aren't really true. There's a lot of stuff going on.
So is the FERCOG looking out for us?
The FERCOG is definitely looking out for us. And. The FERCOG, it doesn't sound like the FERC is really too much on.
They have some questions, I think.
There's questions. So here's this stuff.
Something that I read somewhere in the paper that the town of Deerfield is suing them for something to do with public health. Is that right?
I believe so.
We've been doing that for a while, I thought, yeah.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of people on board.
Within the last week or so that.
We all set, John?
Do I have a motion?
I make a motion that we adjourn.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed.